Great.
I think we can start now.
Okay.
We already, yeah, at time.
I can just then take 20 seconds to introduce you, Thomas. Okay, so it's my pleasure to introduce Thomas Chatain from LMF Paris-Saclay. So Thomas is an assistant professor there. And that lab is like one of the most important labs in the world, studying concurrency theory, infinite state systems, formal methods, and verification. So we owe to them a lot of the foundational results that we use to prove our own theorems. And so in particular, Thomas is interested in formal methods in general, and the application of techniques based on Petri nets and automata based techniques and the like, also with an interest in process mining. So there was a very fruitful collaboration in recent years between Thomas and other people that work actively in the process mining and BPM area, like for example, Josep Carmona, where you can see one of the main topics of this series of seminars, which is combining very well-founded and solid foundational techniques to solve problems that are maybe not standard for people studying Petri nets. And so we have been seeing techniques for reasoning about combined systems encompassing data and dynamics. We have been seeing techniques to reason on stochastic aspects of processes and doing conformance checking. And today, Thomas will talk again about conformance checking, but with this notion of anti-alignment that we'll explain to us. So let me then give the word to you, Thomas, also because there is background noise from my son. So it's better if I mute myself.
Thank you, Marco. Hello to everybody. And then, so it was, you noticed, Marco, that the laboratory changed. So it was an opportunity to show you the new name so that you are familiar if you see us on paper. And hopefully on conferences soon.
There is this very sad story, right, Thomas, that I should have traveled to your lab last year.
Yeah.
Precisely the day where the lockdown
you was initiated. Yeah. Yes, exactly. So, of course, we are looking at process mining aspects, and so I very briefly so say how I understand so process discovery. So you have automatic construction of a model from a log, from an event log that represents a partial observation of the system that you don't know, and so you have as an input something like this, which shows some application of a system, and you want to propose a model for something that could be a model for what the system does. And there are several possibilities to derive a model like that. And there are several miners available, and they can give very different results. Sometimes they would output nets which are very different and could be closer or less related to the log. So here I put extreme cases, three extreme candidates of models that would be candidates for representing a process that would have generated this log. So of course the one that I would like that I would prefer is the one on top right, and there are two extreme cases on bottom left. On the one on bottom left does any action in any order, and the one on bottom right can do only precisely what has been observed in the log and nothing else. So conformance checking is answer the question of defining quality criteria to evaluate these different models and be able to prefer one to the others. So n has to the model has to fit the log, that is the log trace, the observed log traces should be in the language of the model. N should be sufficiently precise, that is the there should not be too many traces which are in the language of the model and not observed in the log. And N should generalize the log, that is, it's expected that the ideal model should contains a few more traces than what has been observed in the log. So it's a bit in opposition to precision, but a good model can be still precise and still a bit generalizing, and we will develop this notion of precision. And nice model also are simple for some notion of simplicity that we can try to define. There are several possible definitions for it, and I'm not going to talk about simplicity. Well, so if I'm back to my example, so for these logs and these three model candidates, the first one, my preferred one on top right, it's fitting, so it can explain, can replay all the logs that were all the traces that were observed in the log. It's fairly precise, that is, it has a few traces which are not have not been observed, but they are not so many, and they are not so far from what has been observed. This is the main aspect. It's relatively simple. Well, this is for the moment, it's just an intuition that it's not a big model. It's something that you can read quite easily, and it generalizes a little bit because it has a few more traces that what has been observed. Now the one on the bottom left, it's again fitting, of course, because it can play everything. So of course it can play what has been observed, but it's very imprecise because it has runs which are very, very far from what has been observed. So this is the big drawback of this problem, of this model. Well, it's quite simple. We can say it's a simple model, but it's bad because it's very imprecise. And it generalizes, of course, but it generalizes a lot too much compared to what we would expect. Then now the one on bottom right, it's perfectly fitting. It's perfectly precise because it does not deviate at all from what has been observed in the log. But it's a big model, not simple. It does not compress information, does not merge transitions, etc. And it does not generalize at all. So this is what we don't like about this model. Now, when I click, so now in conformance checking, you know, there is this notion of alignment, which is very popular, very, very, very useful. So it's used as a first use is to estimate fitness. So if you have a set of logs in the model, you want to check that the model is capable of playing all the traces that has been observed in the log. So and sometimes this is exactly the case. It can exactly replay, and sometimes there are traces which cannot be exactly replayed by the model. But the model can play something very close to the trace. So if I take here the last one from the log, this ABDGHEFI, it's not, so ABDGHEFI, yes, it's not exactly a trace of an execution of the model. But there is we are looking for the best possible alignment, that is the best possible trace of the model, which minimizes the distance to the trace sigma that we want to align to the model. Here on this example, the best alignment that I can find is just to replace the B by the C, and then I get this gamma AC DGHFI, which is a run of the model and aligns pretty well to this log trace. So the model will not be perfectly fitting because it does not fit it cannot play this ABDGHFI, but we can measure that this because of this alignment is very close to the trace, the model will not be penalized too much for this default of fitness. And now, so I'm recalling what alignments are, because I'm now going to speak about anti-alignment. So we are going to take a quite opposite view of this thing. And now the problem is not to estimate fitness, the problem is to estimate precision. That is, we want to point out not the traces of the model which explain the logs, the traces that are in the log, but the traces of the model which are very far from what has been observed in the log. These traces will be interesting because they are the witnesses for imprecisions of the model, and then thanks to these anti-alignments we will be able to give a metric for precision. So here, intuitively, with this small log, it's only a part of the previous log that I had. If I give only this log, then the model here will appear to be imprecise because it can play this ABDEI, and ABDEI is quite far from what has been observed, from what is in the log. Okay. So if this is really the log, then the model can be seen as not too precise because of this anti-alignment ABDI. So let me define to give a more formal definition. So an NM anti-alignment of a model N with respect to a log L would be a run of the model. So a full run of the model, which was to go to the final state. And so here I give a bound on the length, and you will see, I will tell about this later again, because this is something that we prefer to get rid of in the end. The constraint on the anti-alignment, if I want an anti-alignment sufficiently far from the log, so I impose that for every trace in the log, my anti-alignment gamma is sufficiently far from the trace. So distance is larger than it. So there is a notion of distance here in the definition of anti-alignments. So let me discuss what notion of distance we can choose. Well, the most classical notion of distance that we like to apply in conformance checking is the Levenshtein-Eddy distance, and so it counts the number of deletions or insertions of letters needed to edit gamma 2 sigma. As an example, if you take A, B, A, B, A, B, A, B, B, and you want to edit it to B, A, B, A, B, A, B, 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 A, then you just need to drop the first A, for instance, and put it in the end of the word. So it's with two editions you get from one string to the other, which so there would be a distance to. For practical reasons, in some works about anti-alignment, we dealt with the Hamming distance, because it's easier to implement, to encode, etc. So Hamming distance is a bit less satisfactory for, but it's simpler to define. So we for two traces, so if you assume they have the same length, you just compare the number of positions where the two traces differ, and then you count the number of mismatches. Then if you apply this to the same words, ABABABAB and BABABAB, of course they differ in at every position, because it starts with an A and this second start with a B, then the second position you have a B and an A. So you will have distance 10, which is a bit not very nice here, but still in some application you can do you can reason about the Hamming distance and get sufficiently the Hamming distance sometimes can be adapted to etc. You can get decent results with Hamming distance sometimes, and it has some advantages for implementation. So. Now, in the following, I'm going to talk essentially about the Levenstein distance. When if it's the Hamming distance, I will say it. So, an example of anti-alignment. So, if AC with this this log and this model, it's the one I showed before. So I said intuitively that ABDI with what the run in the model that we don't see in the log. And now I can characterize that it's a 5-3 anti-alignment, because it's length 5 and at distance 3 from all the traces in the log. Just to make now to have an idea of the complexity of computing anti-alignments, don't be surprised if the algorithm there are no very efficient algorithms, because the problem of deciding the existence of an NM anti-alignment is NP complete if and M should be represented in unary, because this is for the theorem to be correct, and this is a natural assumption. And well, to prove it, I just give the big line. So the problem is clearly in NP, because it's easy to check that the run is a NM anti-alignment for net N and log L in polynomial time. You just compute the distances, the Levenstein distance you can compute easily. So it's in polynomial time with the classical dynamic programming algorithm. And so this is the easy part. And for NP hardness, you can reduce from the problem of reachability of a marking in a safe acyclic Petri net, which is known to be NP complete. So if you, and now the question is, I introduced anti-alignments to measure precision in the model. So how to define precision for anti-alignments? Then here the idea is to look at the best possible anti-alignment, that is the trace that is as far the trace of the model, the execution of the model, which is as far as possible from the log. Take the distance of this trace to the log, that is the distance of trace to the log is the minimum distance to a trace of the log, and you find you so this gives this is this so this distance of the trace to the log is high when the trace is far from all the traces in the log. Then this you take the max over the traces, and here I put a bound on the length, because I don't want at this stage to explore all the possible traces in the model if there would be infinitely long traces. So this quantity is large if the model is imprecise. And so I put one minus this quantity to get something which is large when the model is precise. Okay, and between 0 and 1. If with this version where I put a bound on the length of the traces, I would like this bound to be sufficiently large so that I can explore significant runs in the log. So n should be in the order of the maximal length for a trace in the log, something like that. Or you can take some integer which represents is related to the size of the model or something like that to get decent n. But then I will explain later how to get rid of this n. If on this example now, I will show this anti-alignment. So if I want to solve the model by decreasing precision, so find for each model the best anti-alignment of lengths smaller than 7. So for the one on top right, the best anti-alignment, now that I have added the ABDEI in the log, so now the model is not as imprecise as it appeared to be without when ABDEI was not in the log, but ABDEI is now in the log. So now the best anti-alignment that I can find is only this ACGHDFI. It's not very far from something observed from some traces in the log, and it gives a precision which is quite close to one. So this model is quite precise. For the second model, flower model, so I have an anti-alignment, for instance, IIIAAA, which is very far from all the observed traces. And this is why I give precision zero. And for the model on the bottom right, there is no anti-alignment. So the model can only play traces which have been observed. So precision is one. So now I said that I had this problem of the bound on the length of the model, on the length of the traces for defining precision, and this is something I wanted to get rid of. But in the first definition, I prefer to keep the n because it was easier. Now let's show what happened when the model has loops. For instance, this model has a loop here, and so a model with executable loops can have arbitrary long runs, and then it means that it has runs arbitrarily far from any finite log, because if the log is finite, of course there is a length of the longest trace observed trace, and then you can if you play the model you can generate very long runs, and they will be of course far from the log. So what we do then is that we drop the bound on the length, on the maximal length, because it's not very nice satisfactory to give this bound hard coded like that. So but what we do is we penalize long runs when we look for the optimal. That is, we consider that having a long run which is far from the log is less serious than having a short run that is far from the log. So in this definition of precision, so it's very close to the previous one. Simply here we consider all the runs, not only those lengths smaller than n. We consider all the runs, but this distance to the log, we divide it by 1 plus epsilon to the length of the gamma. So if the gamma is long, this will be small. So long traces will not be good candidates for anti-alignments. Only sufficiently short traces will be good candidates. Ah, sorry. Sometimes it's when I'm clicking, it's by mistake, it changes the slide. So this epsilon parameter, it should be it's something that should be slightly smaller than zero. If you put it big, well, a bit. If you put it a bit big, it penalizes a lot long run. So you will focus on very short anti-alignment, so traces, very short traces which differ from what the model can do. And if you to the log, and if you have epsilon closer to zero, you penalize little the long run. That is, you allow to look for relatively long runs which differ from the log. So if I give an example for this epsilon equals 0.05 for this log, I consider here two candidates for being anti-alignment. So this ACB, which is short, and it's at distance 0.5 from the log. Then with this penalization of long run, it's little penalized, and then it gives a precision would be if this is the candidate for the worst anti-alignment, it would give precision 0.589. And this trace, which is much longer, it's further from the log. The distance is now 0.556. But because it's long, it's less, we consider less serious the fact that it deviates from the log, and then if we take this trace as the witness for imprecision, it would give a new precision, better precision actually, 0.69. So the what we keep for precision will be the 0.589 of the shorter trace, because it's been more, the shorter trace have been more penalized than the longer trace, which is further, but we don't count it as seriously as the first one. So this gives a metric for precision, and this metric has nice properties that I will show. And these properties actually correspond to some properties that was axiom that were formalized in this article. So they define five axioms that precision metrics should satisfy. And our metric with this epsilon, whatever the epsilon you choose, you fix the epsilon, it satisfies four of these five axioms, and it can be artificially adapted to satisfy the fifth axiom, but the fifth axiom we explained that we find it a bit artificial. So we would prefer not to adapt the metric, to keep it like that and not satisfy the fifth axiom, we could discuss this later. I'm not giving more. Seeing more about this now. So one of the so I'm focusing on the most important axioms to my eyes. So this one is monotonicity with respect to new observations. That is, if you have a model and a log, and you compute the precision of the model with respect to the log, and then a new trace is observed, and it happens that this new trace, it was already predicted by the model. So it was, the model could play it, have this run in its executions, in its language, then the precision this observing this new trace should strengthen the precision of the model. So the precision of the model with the new trace added should be larger than the precision of the model of the initial model with the with respect to the old log. As an example, this gives the following. So imagine I have this model, my favorite model here, and initially I have just a small log. So you could say how can I find this model with this log? But well, imagine I had an expert that told me this is the model, and at the beginning I'm not sure I want to trust him because I have observed only this. So I would consider his model quite imprecise, and I would say because there is if I find the anti-alignment, I find this ABDEI, and I say, well, this is ABDEI. It's quite far from what I have observed in the log. So, and it gives a precision 0.666, which is not very good precision. Okay, but then it happens that I observe ABDEI, and then it kind of confirmed that yes, my expert who gave the model, he was right. So my candidate for anti-alignment now it's not a candidate anymore, and I will find other candidates, but they will not be as far as from the logs. Now the best anti-alignment that I have is on the ACHDFI, and it gives precision 0.769, so better than before. It strengthens the precision of the model. And if imagine that now I observe this ACHDFI, so it's not a candidate again. It's again not a candidate. Then it restricts again my choice of anti-alignments, and I get this ACDHFI, but it's a bit it's again close, not as far from the logs. From the log traces, and then it gives a precision 0.923, and the precision becomes very good. And if I add again I observe again this trace, well, this does not change the precision because I have another anti-alignment which is has the same distance to the log, so it does not change. And this was for the monotonicity for respect to new observed traces. And we have also monotonicity with respect to the model language. So this definition of precision, it's defined actually over the language of the model. It does not consider the syntax, the structure of the model or whatever. It's defined on the language. And so if you give two models, and it happens that the language of one model is included in the language of the other, then you say that the model which has the smaller language should be more precise than the model with a larger language. Model with a larger language may have some traces not in N1 which differ from the log, but the reverse is not possible. So this was for the definition of this precision metric and the main properties. Now we have played with this, and we have looked at algorithms to compute it and implemented some of them. So in theory, how can we compute anti-alignments with this epsilon parameter for long traces? Because for without the epsilon parameter, if you bound the length, it's very easy in theory. You have only finitely many traces to explore. So with this epsilon parameter and all the traces, imagine your model has a loop, you can still rely on a lemma which says that the supremum in this definition of the precision is reached. That is, there exists a full run such that the precision precisely equals 1 minus the distance, this expression, which is in the formula. And this is this gives you the following algorithm, and so you in order to compute the precision, you check you first check if there exists some trace some very first candidate anti-alignment. Which is just a trace of the model, which is not in the log. If this is not possible, if you have no such gamma zero, no such anti-alignment, then you can output precision one. Okay. But if you have one, this gamma zero, then it gives you from this gamma zero, you can compute a bound on the well, you can compute first an M here, and then an N which will be a bound on the length of all possible candidates for anti-alignments. That is, if you playing with these distances and this exponential that you have here, you can show that all the traces which are longer than this N, this expression, then they will necessarily be penalized too much for, because they are too long, they will be penalized too much for being better candidates than the for beating the gamma zero as candidate for anti-alignments. So it's not worth looking further than this N. And then you have only finitely many traces to explore. Then you compute this one minus the max. Now it's a max, it's not a sup. You have only finitely many traces. So you explore the traces which are now bounded by this, of length bounded by this N, and you explore, you return the precision. Please interrupt me if there are some questions. So now in theory, well, of course you can implement this. You can implement this algorithm, but it will certainly not be very efficient just as such, because it's a bit extensive exploration of the execution of the model. So something that we tried first is to solve this problem, is to encode this problem as a SAT formula, and call a SAT solver for this. So we write a formula which depends on this N and M and the log and the model and the log, and encode the fact that gamma is a NM anti-alignment. That is, gamma is an execution of the model, and it's for every trace of the log, it's the gamma is sufficiently far from this trace. So, in order to encode to do this encoding, you need a Boolean formula with the variables that say toit that say transition. The ice transition in the gamma is the transition t of the model, and this MIP which say what is the marking the intermediate after the ice firing in the sequence, and then these encode the mismatches for the distances. In the end, you have a formula, SAT formula, which has size polynomial in the input. But it's still it gives quite big formulas. This is just to show a little bit more how we can encode the fact that the gamma is a run of the model. Well, you can look at this in detail if you want, but I won't detail this now. And for the distance, so for the distance, maybe it's a little useful to show how we do this. So for Hamming distance, it's quite easy because you have so for Hamming distance, you have when you have the two traces, you have a formula that says that there are sufficiently many must be sufficiently many mismatches, and for Levenstein's edit distance, then it's much more tricky to encode in SAT formula that two traces, they are sufficiently far from the Levenstein edit distance. And actually what we do is that we encode the relation that follows the idea of the classical algorithm for computing the Levenstein edit distance, that is you recognize the classical rules for this algorithm, and they can be translated in the SAT formula. But for this we use this many variables, so the delta ijd, which says that distance of the prefix of u, the ith prefix of u, and to the jth prefix of j of v is larger than d. So it's a lot of variables and a lot of formulas to constrain that the Levenstein edit distance is well encoded. So for this SAT encoding, we can still compute anti-alignments for the Hamming distance quite easy, quite well, for reasonably models which are actually quite big here, but the length of the log should not contain too many traces, because each trace is encoded separately, so it makes a lot of clauses. Of course, if you have logs with many duplicates you can remove the duplicates, so it helps quite a lot, but still you are limited by the size of the logs. And actually what limits most this algorithm is the size, the you have big SAT formula, and when you solve them, you use a lot of memory. So you have the computation time is not so catastrophic, but the memory use is often the limit. So this was for Hamming distance. You can still deal with decent models. For Levenstein distance, it's as I said, the encoding of Levenstein distance as that formula is much more consuming in clauses and variables, and so you are limited to much shorter models. So we could still handle 40 places and transitions, but the size of logs here should be really smaller. So still it can be useful to test the algorithm on some small examples to compare to other algorithms, but the time consumption and space consumption are high. So for this from this limits of the SAT encoding technique, we decided to move to approximation of anti-alignments with a discounted edit distance, and then we are moving to heuristics to find this gives heuristics to find the anti-alignments much quicker. So the idea is simply the following: if the definition of Levenstein edit distance, you have this. Well, one way to define it like that you have these inductive definition, Levenstein distance between two empty bodies zero, and distance to over and the empty bodies the length of u, etc. And okay, this gives the classical definition of Levenstein distance. And what we decide to do is to say that we are going to penalize more the edits that occur early in the world. That is, if you are comparing two traces and they differ from right from the beginning, we will penalize more on this. And this is easy to define a modified Levenstein edit distance for that. So we call it the discounted edit distance. It has a parameter theta which says how much we penalize. We penalize the early mismatches, the early edits. And then this discounted edit distance between U and V, it's very close to the definition of Levenstein edit distance. Simply, when you progress in the world, you have this k which increases. It increased, and then you will penalize less when you have progressed in the world. The edits late in the world cost less than the edits early in the world. This gives on these examples, it gives that in order to edit A B C D to B C D, you need to drop the first A. It's at the very beginning of the word. Then it costs theta to the minus zero. That is, it costs one. Okay, so distance is one. And if you now you want to edit A B C D to A B C. There is also only one letter to drop, but now it's the final D. And because it's at the end of the word, it costs less than dropping the first A. So now it costs theta to the minus 6, which is 0.56. So this will be considered closer, artificial. Well, a bit artificially, we make ABC closer to ABCD than BCD is close, and BCD further from ABCD. So now from this discounted edit distance, we define discounted anti-alignments. And is discounted anti-alignment is a run of the model, which maximizes its discounted edit distance to the log n. And the motivation, there are two motivations, because there is a practical interest for the algorithm, which I said, and also you can when you think of it, you can find that for many models, it's reasonable to say that let's start by the beginning and see if when I'm exploring my process, let's see if at the beginning of the process already it mismatches to it with the log. Then I should penalize the model a lot for that. And if the beginning also as opposite to in the is if the process starts correctly and then after long execution it derives a bit from what has been observed in the log, maybe this is less severe than I should penalize less for that. So this, well, it was first our intention was to provide an efficient algorithm, but it seems to us very reasonable from a practical point of view. So we can easily motivate that it's a reasonable assumption to penalize more the deviations early, which happen early in the traces or in the log traces or model traces. So and the practical interest, it was to design an efficient algorithm, and it worked very well. As you will see, so it speeds up a lot the search algorithm for an A-star, for an A-star based algorithm. And even when the theta is very close to one, actually, very, very quickly, you see the speed up, impressive speed up. To illustrate the influence of the discount parameter theta, so this is on the small model. But you see that with 1.1, you get this anti-alignment, and you find it in 0.05 time. You select. So if you have if you have a higher theta, it allows you to it allows the A-star algorithm to select earlier what are the promising candidates for being anti-alignment, because those who deviate from the beginning, even if they align quite well with the logs afterwards, because they deviate at the beginning, they will be penalized a lot. So you can already search in this direction. And if you find other traces, which other model executions, which at the beginning do not deviate from the log, then you say that even if later they will deviate, this will not compensate the difference with the traces which have deviated earlier. So when you augment this the theta, you are able to do this selection more efficiently, and then to converge more easily to the optimal discounted anti-alignment. So it's not the computation time increases. For the flower model, it's even more impressive, because for 1.5 you get this computation time, and for 2 you get a very much shorter computation time. The flower model is very very specific case also. Now we have done many experiments with this discounted eddy distance, because it's really. Now, with this discounted eddy distance, you can compute anti-alignment. So it's discounted anti-alignment. So they are not the exactly the optimal ones for with that we would get with the normal Levenshtein eddy distance. But they show to be very close in the end. They are quite close to what we to the ones with Levenshtein eddy distance. So here we see for several models the anti-alignment that we find with the Levenshtein eddy distance, and the one that we find with the discounted eddy distance with some parameter theta that I don't even did not write here. But you see that so many times it's exactly the same anti-alignment. Sometimes they differ. Okay, but in the end, if you take the the anti-alignment that you found with the discounted eddy distance, even if you use this one to compute the precision, you get something very close to the true precision that would be computed with the true optimal with Levenshtein eddy distance. So they differ very little. Many times they are exactly the same. And if you this good approximation of the optimal anti-alignments, and as you see from the last column, the computation time is absolutely incomparable. And now we can use this we want to compare this metric that we have for anti-alignments with other metrics. So this is on larger models, big models, and from the BPI challenge. And we compare to this ETC map EMP metrics. You can see that we have the precision that we compute in here in this last column of the precision, it's always it always agrees with at least one of the other metrics, which is not the case of the others. So the others sometimes they agree, sometimes they disagree. Sometimes they are very very different things. Here, for instance, if you compare this the map and the EMP for this BPI this model, they differ a lot. And we are always agree with one of the other metrics. So it's quite encouraging. And for the runtime, we compare well to other metrics. Yeah, it's they are comparable. So sometimes we are a bit better, sometimes we are a bit less. So it's very very comparable. So it's now anti-alignments are really usable for big models for you. And so we are very happy of this. To conclude, so we have defined anti-alignment, which has the run of the model, which maximizes the distance to the observed traces, gives a trick for precision, which has satisfied the good properties that we like, essentially. In particular, the fact that it's monotonic with respect to new observations. It's implemented, so first in the DarkSider tool, and which was using the SATAN coding, which is available here, and then as a PM4PY module, and we have the discounted edit distance that were computed with this module. And with the discounted distance, we have a really efficient implementation. And there are of course perspectives to deal with data in the logs and in the model. So how to compute precision for models where you have when you take into account the information about the timestamps, the information about the user IDs, etc. For this, you need richer classes of models. And also use this. There are several other uses for anti-alignments. One use is for precision. So it was redesigned for precision at the beginning, but we also use these anti-alignments once defining a metric for generalization, and also the main perspective for using this anti-alignment is to perform model repair. So this anti-alignment, it points out to the traces of the model which differ from the log, and then it's where the model has to be repaired. So it locates the problems in the model. So using these anti-alignments in model repair, it's a big perspective for this using these anti-alignments. Thanks.
Thank you, Tamar, for the very interesting talk. And there are questions. See that there is a question by Anna. Maybe Anna, you just thank you.
Thank you very much for nice presentation. And I don't understand actually question concerning how we can include in model some unusual situation, for example, some accidents and which situation, if we does not mention it in the model of patternets, it does not decrease very too much the precision precision of the model, but it can be very important to include the path of this unusual situation in the model. So how we can say that the model has some quality, some precision, can be precise when we does not include such situation.
So maybe you mean that there are some error situations or accidental situations that you still you want to put them in the model, but you don't want to count them as imprecisions, even if they were not observed, right?
Mm-hmm. Yes. If we does not include this log in our model, because we have another path, another anti-alignment, yeah.
Yes. So I see two ways of specifying this. So well, of dealing with this thing. So maybe the best way would be to put some information on some, if you have some transition in the model which are considered unusual or something, but you want to put them in the model, but you could say, you could put some information on them, some kind of weight, to say that the traces in the model that take this transition, just they should be penalized, they should as anti-alignment, so they should be considered, you should consider that it's expected that the traces which take these transitions, they were not observed, and then you can just simply decide to remove them from the case. So in the definition of anti-alignments, maybe. You can go to the definition. You could. Yeah.
So some problems with sounds.
The definition of the line, sorry, not here. We'll take the sorry. I will find it. Here, well, this is when the definition of for the definition of precision. I mean, for the definition of precision, you have this quantification over the traces of the model. So one thing that you can do is these traces of models into two sets. So you have the normal traces and the accidental traces, and you consider only normal traces in the quantification. Or alternatively, you can say that you take all the traces which will penalize the traces which are considered accidental, then you will not pay, you will not take them. You will not take them into. So something else.
Sorry, Thomas, but maybe if there are some problems traces,
you
with
could,
hearing you. So just.
Sorry.
Now it looks okay, but when you were. So it's previous few minutes, so there was some
you could not hear me.
So noise.
There was noise. Okay.
Yeah.
Let me repeat a bit. I propose to an answer to your question to say that in the definition of precision, if you want to take into account the fact that some traces are in the model, but you consider that they are extreme cases, which and it's likely that they it's expected that they were not observed because they you consider that they are exceptional, then you could either quantify on this sub you could quantify only over the traces which are normal considered normal traces and not considered the other ones, or alternatively you can keep the quantification over all traces, but you put in this expression some quantity which penalizes a lot the traces which are considered accidental, and then they will not participate in the definition of the precision. And then I see a last solution if the accidental traces are sufficiently few and sufficiently well identified, you can simply artificially add them to the log, and then they will disappear as they will not be any more candidates for anti-alignment because they were in the log, so they would be considered close to the log.
I see. Thank you.
Thank you. So, more questions? So then it looks like there are no questions, and so then I would like to thank Toma once more for really interesting talk. Of course, it's always a very difficult subject when you can't formulate the problem purely mathematically, because so just you should take heuristics into account, and this definition should meet some intuition we have in mind, and of course for each actually a definition there could be a counterexample, but I think that your solution is really beautiful and so just and it is practically applicable. That's great. So thank you.
Thanks.
Thank you for everybody.
Yeah, looking forward to see you in person.
Yeah.
Sorry for that. I did not. Yes. See, I did not open the video because it's making a Zoom bug on my computer. It freezes my computer, so I can say hello maybe now if it's still time. So you can check that I was the one speaking. And, hello. Goodbye to everybody. Good evening.
Good evening.
Bye. Bye. Thanks.
Thanks.
Thank you.